Und nachdem wir nun erfahren haben, wie die ökumenische Wassererklärung entstanden ist, wofür sie einsteht und welchen Impuls sie ausgelöst hat, werden wir im folgenden Referat von Maud Barlow mehr über die Bedeutung von Wasser als Menschenrecht und öffentliches Gut erfahren. Maud Barlow gilt weltweit als eine der renommiertesten Wasseraktivistinnen. Sie engagiert sich nicht nur als Vorsitzende einer Umwelt- und Sozialbewegung, dem Council of Canadians. Sie war auch Senior Advisor für den 63. Präsidenten der UN-Vollversammlung. Für ihr unermüdliches Engagement wurde sie mit zahlreichen Preisungen und Ehrungen ausgezeichnet. Unter anderem erhielt sie den Right Livelihood Award, der vielleicht besser bekannt ist unter dem Namen Alternativer Nobelpreis. Auch dieses Referat wird von Helena Nieberg übersetzt. Vielen Dank, Helena, für deine Übersetzung. Dear Maud, thank you very much for visiting us again in Switzerland. We are looking forward to learn more about the right to water and water as public good as precondition for access to water for all. The stage is yours.
Guten Morgen. Dear Pia, dear Heinz, dear Lisa, dear friends, I'm very thrilled to be with you this morning. I'm sorry I don't speak German. If anyone wants a translation device, needs it, I think they're here being handed out. I'm going to speak slowly. Helen, our translator, is going to, I hope, be happy with me because I will try to, she's waving at me, to speak slowly so that if you're listening in English, I'll speak slowly and that's good. If you're listening in the translation, she needs extra time, or one always needs extra time. So I'm thrilled to be here. And I'm going to read my notes. I don't usually read, but I wanted to prepare these for the translator. So I have so many things to share with you and I want them to be specific. I want to say exactly what from my heart to you. I'm delighted to return to your wonderful OMA Blue Community, to share this day celebrating Blue Communities here in Switzerland and around the world. In a world with many, many troubles, it is important to celebrate our progress in the areas of human rights and water protection. Outside of Canada, Switzerland has more blue communities than anywhere else in the world. And it was really wonderful to hear Pia's history of how it started, this discussion started between the faith-based groups in Brazil, connected by Franklin Frederick, connected back to Switzerland, and what an incredible partnership this has been. Yet the concept is taking off. Pia talked about São Lourenço in Brazil. Cambuquira, Brazil has become the first blue community in South America as it is trying to protect its beautiful mineral water heritage from being destroyed the way Nestle has destroyed the neighboring community of São Lourenço, where the company took over the water park, famous for its healing properties, to get access to some of the purest water for export, and of course for profit. Berlin has a group organizing to have that city become a blue community. You may know that Berlin's water was privatized, and they brought their water back into public hands. It was a huge fight. And the same group doesn't want it to be privatized again, so they want Berlin to become a blue community, and we're working with them, and they're in touch with Lisa, who's helping them. And we're working with a number of cities on the American side of the Great Lakes who also want to declare themselves blue. And we're very proud of the fact that there are 18 cities or communities in municipalities in Canada that have become blue communities and have pioneered this concept. We started it with the Canadian Union of Public Employees, which is our major public sector union in Canada. Originally envisaged as a way to protect water as a human right and a public trust, the concept has grown. Byrne added the promise to promote public partnerships in the global south, instead of the World Bank-favored public-private partnerships that have created so much hardship and so much opposition in poor countries of the global south, from Latin America and Africa in particular. Some communities want to extend the definition of blue community to include, for instance, bans on fracking. Fracking's becoming an issue here in Europe. It's a huge issue in North America. Or intrusive mining projects, such as Canadian mines operating in a number of countries, particularly in South America, that destroy local water sources. Like the fight for human rights to water and sanitation, blue communities will develop and evolve with time and the wisdom of the local groups and the local communities and the local municipalities, universities, and unions. And you should know that in Canada, we've just got our first two Indigenous, we call them First Nations, blue communities. One is in central British Columbia and one is in southern Alberta. And this one in southern Alberta is called the Blood Tribe. Absolutely huge, one of the hugest, largest First Nations territories in North America. And a community racked with a lot of violence, a lot of intrusion of industry coming in and taking their resources, and the people are saying, no, we're going to protect our water. Like the fight for the human rights to water and sanitation, Blue Communities is a project of hope. So you don't have to feel that you're always fighting against something, that you can in fact be for something, and it's really wonderful. So why do we need Blue Communities? Well, the world has a major water crisis that we're just beginning to understand. We are damming our rivers to death and we are mining groundwater far faster then nature can replenish it. Using borewell technology, only perfected in recent decades, humans are depleting the water sources of future generations. US-based NASA has recently discovered how to use satellite technology to assess the world's groundwater, the supplies of the Earth's groundwater. In a report several months ago, the agency said that there are now 37 major aquifers in the world, major groundwater aquifers. And of those 37 groundwater aquifers, 21 are in serious trouble. 8 are being, and they use the term, sucked dry. This means that in the lifespan of one generation of humans, we are using up the water that has been there for millennia and that does belong to the future as well as us. Over half the rivers in China have disappeared. They don't know where they went. I know where they went. They went for the economic miracle to produce all the toys and so many of the products to make China richer, but there's been a terrible price to their water. 22 countries in Africa are in water crisis, as are India and Pakistan. Mexico is sinking as its groundwater has been totally pumped. So if you go to Mexico, you'll see that the churches are kind of falling on their side. Some of them you actually kind of have to walk in this way. It's called subsidence, when you pump the water out underneath the ground. The earth starts to sink. And huge parts of the United States, not just California, huge parts of the United States are in serious drought, as is the west of Canada, which is one of the most water-rich countries in the world. And we have scientists in our country who tell us that we are about to experience drought on the prairies as bad as the drought of the 1930s. This is in a country with so much water. Once water-rich Brazil is also in severe drought because they cut down their rainforest that provided so much moisture for air currents. These air currents are called flying rivers, and they carry the rain from the rainforest thousands of kilometers away, and they bring it to places like Sao Paulo. Sao Paulo has 20 million people, and they are running out of water. They are absolutely desperate. And I think Brazil is probably the most important story in the world, because until very recently, Brazil was considered the country with the most water in the world. So it's a lesson for countries like Switzerland and Canada, and for sure, a lesson for countries that don't even start with huge amounts of water. One global study said that at current rate of water consumption, our demand for water will outstrip supply by 40% by 2030. Now stop and try to think what this means. The demand for water is going straight up and the supply is going straight down. We all learned when we were young that that couldn't happen, that there's an exact amount of water on the planet and it can't go anywhere. And that lesson was wrong. We have to take that tape out of our head. We have to delete that lesson and we have to replace it with a knowledge that we are destroying the world's water heritage at an incredibly quick rate. In my opinion, this is the first face of climate change and more of a severe problem than climate change as we have understood it. And I also want to say that our destruction of water and our moving it from watersheds is also one of the causes of climate change. And I will be going to Paris tomorrow to be there for the climate summit, and I'm going to be working with colleagues to tell the story about how not only our destruction of watersheds is damaging local hydrologic cycles, but that retention and restoration of our water systems is one of the antidotes, one of the solutions to the climate crisis. And this clearly, this crisis, ecological crisis, impacts our struggle to provide safe, clean, and accessible water and sanitation to the world. As the insatiable demand for water grows, there's a grab by the powerful, and many poor people in both the global north and the global south are now being left behind. And I really want to stress that in our struggle to make the human right to water real, we're coming right up against the ecological crisis. Now, there is some good news. There have been real and exciting improvements since 2010, when the United Nations recognized the human rights to water and sanitation. Let me tell you, I was very involved in that struggle, and it was not an easy struggle. Many countries, including my own, were opposed to the human right to water. The World Bank was opposed. The big water companies were opposed. Nestle was opposed. The big food companies were opposed. And we didn't think we were going to win. We worked very closely with a small group of people, and the ambassador from Bolivia put the question to the United Nations. I thought we were going to lose. I was standing there with my staff and they were crying. We were up in the balcony of the UN General Assembly and they were crying because we thought we were going to lose the vote. And I said, don't worry, we'll be back in 2 years or 5 years or whatever. And we'll get, but just to be here now is so important. But when they voted, 122 countries voted in favor. Not one voted against. They didn't have the United States and Canada didn't have the nerve to vote against. They abstained. 41 countries abstained. And in my opinion, the human species, the human race, took an evolutionary step forward on that day, because we decided that it's not all right. It is not okay that someone has to watch their child die of waterborne disease because they're poor and cannot afford water. That's not okay. And the whole human family said that day, this is how we feel. So there have been some real and exciting improvements. At the UN, every country, even the ones that objected at the time, every country has now recognized the human rights to water and sanitation. And the special rapporteurs on the human rights to water and sanitation have traveled and written extensively to ensure governments around the world take their obligations on this very seriously. The current rapporteur, Leo Heller, is from Brazil and is wonderful and doing a wonderful job. About 4 dozen countries have either enshrined the right to water within their national constitutions or in new legislation. Give you an example, after Mexico amended its constitution to recognize the human right to water, civil society groups used that constitutional amendment to successfully challenge a water privatization bill that the government put forward. The groups there said, wait a minute, you can't say that it's a human right in the constitution and then bring in a bill to force the privatization of water services. And they won, based on the fact that Mexico had made this change to its constitution. Courts are also being used to challenge the violation of the right to water. Governments are now obliged to implement the right to water into their national legal systems, and courts are now obliged to ensure their laws are interpreted consistently with international human rights law. This is very exciting and very new. I'll give you some examples. The Bombay High Court ruled that the city government was duty-bound to supply water to illegal slums. An Indonesian court annulled a public-private partnership, saying that it violated the human right to water. A French court banned water cutoffs to the poor in that country. A court in Flint, Michigan, just recently did the same thing. And we worked with the Kalahari Bushmen in Botswana to get their right to return to the desert and have their water systems reopen because the government had smashed their bore wells because they wanted the Bushmen off the Kalahari because they discovered diamonds. And the people kept coming back, but they got the right to go back to the desert, but they didn't get the right to water. But when the resolution from the UN was adopted, they went with the support of myself and Survival International, they went back to court. And this time the court said, if the United Nations recognizes the human right to water, we recognize the human right to water. And the night that I received my lovely Right Livelihood Award, one of the Kalahari Bushmen also received it. And it was in Stockholm, in the evening, on a December night. It was very cold, and everyone was dressed very beautifully. It was in the old parliament, and it was lit by torches, and children singing Ave Maria were in a choir were going in front of us, and they were wearing the candles on their heads. It was very beautiful. The women were all beautifully dressed, and the men in suits. And Roy Shoshana, the person who is receiving it on behalf of the Kalahari Bushmen, wore his traditional outfit, which was a loincloth, a feather, and a spear. I thought, good for you, good for you. It was beautiful. He was cold, I'm gonna just say that. He was a little bit chilly, but he was magnificent. So we're very, very pleased that we managed to safeguard the human rights to water in the recent. Now, you know that the SDGs, the Social Development Goals, came up again at the UN in 2015, and so there was a huge fight whether we were going to get the human right to water and sanitation recognized. And yes, we did indeed get the human right to water and sanitation written clearly into the new SDGs. The UN likes to assure us, but I want to just say the UN says, well, we have gone a long way to our 2000 promise on the human right to water. And that's true to some extent, but I will share with you a concern, and that is the way the United Nations calculates who has water and who doesn't is how many new pipes have been put into each country. But that doesn't tell you that the pipes are close to the people. And those pipes may not contain clean water. It may be contaminated water, or the pipes may be privatized, and people cannot afford them. So just because there's a certain number of pipes does not necessarily mean that people have this access to water. So I don't quite trust the UN statistic. They say, I think it's 800,000 people don't, a million don't have access to water. I think it's probably much more, like probably 1.5 billion, but certainly it's still unacceptable. And in fact, and I want to say that in fact, that even with the successes outlined, the problems are still staggering. 2.5 billion people still have no access to sanitation. A billion people in the world defecate in the open. I've been in the Kerala slum in a community. I shouldn't call it a slum because people live and work and try to have a good life there in Kenya. And they have what they call flying toilets, which is that they defecate into plastic bags and then throw them into the water systems. And we're talking about a million people living there. So try caring about the environment there. You can't. You have to ensure human rights at the same time or before you can even start to talk about the environment. In fact, even with the successes outlined, we still know, even where access has improved, almost 2 billion people are forced to use a source of water that is contaminated. So even if people have this access to water, the water is not clean, and that's what's killing children. We know that in the global south, a child dies of waterborne disease every 3.5 seconds. Now, water cutoffs have spread to rich countries in Europe and in the United States. It's very important to know this, where tens of thousands of people have had their water cut off from an inability to pay the higher rates. In Europe, it's been the austerity project. Countries are forced to either raise their water rates or privatize their water, and then the private companies really raise the rates. And people in Europe don't know that there have been thousands of cutoffs in Spain and Italy and Greece particularly, and Hungary and France, until France banned cutoffs. In the United States, inner city Detroit has cut off the water to tens of thousands of poor African American unemployed people who cannot afford the water rates that had doubled and then they tripled. Impossible. People cannot pay the water rates. And try to imagine, you're sound asleep at 6 o'clock in the morning and these trucks arrive and these big guys get out. They're not public water workers, these are private companies. And they come in and they cut the water off to the whole area, the whole neighborhood. Even people who've paid, they just cut the water at source. No water for showering, no water to flush your toilet, no water to cook, no water to care for your children, no water to care for elderly, and it takes weeks and months and sometimes years to get that water turned back on. I've met people in Detroit, in a first world country, right on the Great Lakes, who haven't had water for 2 years. So they take their buckets, just like people in the global south, and they go anywhere they can to try to fill up water to come back. So it's really important we understand that the economic globalization has meant that we have a global south in the global north now, and a global north in the global south. There's wealth and 1% in the global south, and that poverty has moved north as well. Of course, is staying in the south. We have what I call a perfect storm of declining water sources and rising water rates, often because of privatization, and a growing gap between rich and poor in our world and in each country. And so we are seeing that globalization brings some good things, but some very terrible things as well, and it makes us more one family than ever before. As well, many governments have other priorities. They pay lip service to these human rights, these water human violations, but in many countries, indigenous peoples bear the brunt of water injustice. Many governments give priority access to mining, energy, and agribusiness corporations. We work with people in countries in Latin America where the governments give usually Canadian mining companies 25-year tax-free status. They can abuse the local people. The government looks the other way. They can do whatever they want to the water. In fact, in Chile, Chile has public auctions where they auction the actual water, not just privatization. And big mining companies from my country come in and they outbid the local farmers, the local villagers, the local communities who can't afford the water prices. And so then these companies own the water. They actually own the physical water. And then they are able to dump their toxins in absolutely legally. And this is a practice that is in far too many countries in the global south who are desperate to bring any kind of jobs or any kind of investment to their community. Real life and death decisions are made when some governments deny water to villagers, small farmers and indigenous people and slum dwellers in favor of building industrial development, free trade zones. I write in my new book about Karnataka in India, which is a state that wants to become the Silicon Valley of India, and they actually are giving preferential use of their water to free trade zones and industrial zones over people who are literally desperate for water in their community. Adherence to macroeconomic policies such as unlimited growth, deregulation of environmental protection, and corporate-driven free trade agreements such as CETA, which is the new proposed agreement between Canada and Europe, and TTIP, which is the new proposed agreement between Europe and the United States, and TISA, the new services agreement, which Switzerland is very involved in and is going to be negotiated in Geneva. All of these put a lock on privatization and basically force us to bring our standards down to the lowest common denominator. They give corporations more rights than citizens and in many cases more rights than governments. Many governments also favor military and security spending over providing basic services. Global military spending now stands at $1.76 trillion annually, a sum that towers over the estimated $10 billion it would take to provide water services for all. The world is so lopsided, and of course the recent terrorism tragedies are going to make the bill for security and militarism increase everywhere. Corporations also have undue influence at the World Bank and at the United Nations. Switzerland's Nestle head, Peter Brabeck, advises the World Bank how to privatize water services in poor countries, while his company makes huge profits selling Pure Life water to the poor in those countries. I believe this is a profound conflict of interest and should be stated. So we must continue to advocate for the human right to water while we work to save the planet's precious water supplies. We need to think sustainability and justice always at the center of our thinking. It's a new water ethic. And we need to ask at all times, what is the impact of the way we grow food or the way we produce energy or the way we trade on water? And if the impact is not good on water, we have to stop. We have to go back and start again. This means defending water as a public trust and a commons that belongs to local communities and ecosystems and future generations who have the same rights to water as we do. Governments hold these water sources in trust for us. And all uses of water must be judged by the twin criteria of justice of access and sustainability, long-term sustainability of the watershed. Water must never be appropriated for profit, private profit, and must never be put on the open market for sale. Similarly, we must reject public-private partnerships. Public Services International, which is the international Federation of Public Sector Unions, reports that the best guarantee of success for safe drinking water is public delivery by governments, and that even the poorest governments, with help and support, can provide water and sanitation to their people. Over a 10-year period, water services can be delivered for less than 1% of each country's GDP. Public Services International says all countries can afford this. This is an affordable and reasonable goal. We don't need big private utilities coming in and running water services. And it is a contradiction, in my opinion, to support and benefit from public services, public water services in countries like Canada and Switzerland, while promoting private services in the global south and sending our corporations there to make money if public water services are right here in Switzerland, in Canada, in Europe, why are they not right everywhere? In fact, you should know that since the year 2000, 235 municipalities around the world that tried privatization said that was a terrible mistake and have gone back. They have remunicipalized their water systems, including big cities like Paris and Berlin. So they have rejected these experiments and brought water back under public control. And this is why it is very important for governments and aid agencies of the global north, from my country, from European countries, from Switzerland, such as the Swiss Development Corporation, Alliance Sud, and the Water Partnership, to promote public-public partnerships in developing countries. The UN is very clear that it is governments who have the primary responsibility to uphold the human rights to water and sanitation, even when the services are given out to a third party. The United Nations says that water services must be transparent, they must involve the community, and they must enforce standards, all of which the private operators studiously avoid. And in its latest publication, the Swiss Development Corporation touts public-private partnerships in water and other areas. And I really think we need to collectively challenge this adherence to a private model, because the Global South is rejecting it. They don't want this model, and it is an imposition of something that we don't even want here in the Global North. We need the voice of the Swiss agencies to support water as a human right, as a public trust, and as a public service. This is a crucial moment in our struggle for water justice. So in closing, so that I can have time to speak with you and not just at you, I would suggest four things that we need to do fairly urgently. We need to use the United Nations Declaration, the Resolutions on Human Rights to Water and Sanitation, plus the new Social Development Goals, to push our courts and our governments even further in fulfilling the promise of water for all. We have to use them to stop the worldwide cutoffs of water and the destruction of local water sources by extractive industries. And one of the obligations on governments is not just to fulfill water and sanitation as a human right, but it's also very clear that the obligations are that governments cannot cut water from people who already have it. And third, governments have the responsibility, the obligation, to stop third-party destruction of water sources. So we're working with some people in Latin America who are going to use the human right to water to challenge mining companies in their countries and the destruction that they're doing to their local water. Secondly, we have to put the human rights to water and sanitation at the very heart of the ecological struggle to protect our water and watersheds. It's very clear, and I've watched this over the years, countries hit by droughts and water shortages are now beginning to come up with serious plans to deal with their water crisis. They're beginning to understand that these are not cyclical droughts, but actual permanent water crises. And so what the United Nations says is that the most vulnerable must be protected within these plans, or they'll be left behind. And as I said earlier, many, many countries are saying there's a limited amount of water. We want to use it for economic development, a certain model of industrial development. And they're just leaving whole parts of their humanity, of their citizens behind. The United Nations says that cannot happen. You have to put the vulnerable, the most vulnerable, at the very heart of all your water plans. Thirdly, we have to fight for a just economy. And this is a much larger task, but one that faith-based groups around the world have taken up as an important milestone, an important touchstone in all of their work and your work. We have to say that trade agreements and the economy and economic policies must serve people and communities, not the other way around. And I would argue now that we are in many ways used to promote the interests of the 1%. And just last month, the scale tipped and the top 1% officially now owns 50% of the world's wealth. I mean, that is profoundly wrong. There is something profoundly wrong with that. And continuing with macroeconomic policies that say, let the corporations self-govern, and trade agreements that give corporations the right to sue governments if they don't like their laws and tell governments what policies they're allowed to have, and policies that deregulate financial markets so that the financial institutions and the hedge funds can do what they want, and if they make a mess of it like they did in 2008, they get bailed out. There's something profoundly wrong with this, and we're not going to solve the climate crisis or the ecological crisis or the water crisis or the human crisis or the lack of equality in our world until we confront these realities. I had the honor of debating Chancellor Merkel in the spring, because when Germany hosts the G7 or the G8, depending on whether Russia's in or out, maybe they're in again, the Chancellor agrees to have a day with civil society. So I was invited to be one of the people. And Chancellor Merkel talked about the concerns of the SDGs and what they were going to talk about at the G7, about the empowerment of women and about the growing gap between rich and poor, and about the climate crisis, which I think she really cares about. I really do. I think that she means that. I think she might mean it all. But I said to her, that's all very well and good to say that there's all this happening here, but the only treaties that you sign, or any of our governments sign, are these trade and investment treaties that have enforcement power. None of the others have enforcement. You can't make anybody fulfill their agreements on human rights or any ecological or any labor standard agreement. It's a kind of a gentle person's agreement. But when you mean it, and when the corporations mean it, they have enforcement mechanisms that can take small countries down or can wipe out whole industries, can wipe out basically whole populations in a way. And so you can't have it both ways. You can't have these economic policies on one side that favor the 1% and give corporations free rein, and on the other hand say, well, we care about the poor. No, you don't. You can't have it both ways. You can't have it. We're going to have to change these fundamentals. And it's a huge job, but I honestly think that the old system's like a great big set of dinosaurs. I think they're faltering under their own weight, and I think a new day is waiting to be born. I actually do. And finally, then, we need to promote blue communities here in Switzerland and around the world. In a world fighting poverty, climate change, violence, and terrorism, it is wonderful to have a project based on hope so that water stewards like you, water stewards everywhere, can take a positive stand for water justice and human rights. And as a last word, I just want to say that I'm worried about growing conflict in the world over water. If you look at the crisis in the Middle East, every single one of them has an element of water crisis at its base. I'm not saying it's the only thing, but every single one of them has some form of a water crisis. In Egypt, it was water privatization that put the price of water totally out of reach to people. In Syria, it was a terrible drought 10 years ago that actually, where Assad actually gave water systems and farmland over to his cronies, and they started pumping up the groundwater and used up water that should have been there for the people, and millions of millions of displaced farmers and indigenous or small farmers of people left the land and moved south. So water has been used as a weapon of war in Syria and other places. So I asked myself, is this the future? Is the future going to be a fight over water? Is it going to be conflict and violence and war? Or is it possible that water can become nature's gift to humanity to teach us how to live better with one another and to live more lightly on the earth? Because it's a dream that I have, but I also know of situations, really good situations, where warring communities have come together and said, let's put aside religion and history and politics and just work to save this river or this watershed, because if we don't, you'll die and I'll die, or we'll all move. And so hating each other is kind of a waste of time at the moment. We have to turn to this crisis. And I worry going into Paris that the issue is going to be terrorism and the issue isn't going to be the global climate water crisis that we're facing. And as a human species, we have to rise to this occasion. So I thank you very much for the honor of sharing this with you this morning and for the commitment that you would have on a Saturday to be here to care so deeply about the human right to water here and around the world. Dankeschön.
Thank you very much for your committed presentation. There are some signs of hope with the human right to water. On the other hand, many challenges we are facing now. I especially liked your suggestions concerning the role of the governments, as they seem to be a key player in the question about access to water. But I also liked what you mentioned about the role of the Swiss players in development cooperation, and as announced in our program, we are going to tackle this question again this afternoon with a plenary discussion with different representatives. Now, I'm sure some people have comments and questions. Es bleibt uns etwas Zeit für Kommentare und Fragen an Maud Barlow.
Yeah. My husband says, do people really willingly go to hear you? Because he says, I upset people. That's why he's not here today. He's out walking around enjoying your city. It's true.
Thank you very much for your wonderful speech. I really liked it. I would be interested to know what Merkel replied when you asked this question.
Who's asked? Where? Oh, right here. Okay. Yes. I have to say I liked Angela Merkel. I have to say I liked the person that I met. I gave her a copy of my book, Blue Future, in German, and I'd signed it, and I handed it to her, and then I went to take it from her just so she wouldn't have to hold it. She said, no, 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 that's mine. And then she said, did you sign it? And so we smiled, and then when I spoke, we've just had an election in Canada. We have a very wonderful new government. Not going to be perfect, but they are so much better than what we had. We call it the lost decade in Canada. For instance, our last government under Stephen Harper gutted all of our freshwater laws, like all of them. They're just gone. I mean, we have no protections left because the energy industry said, well, we'll invest more money if you take away these problems of these pesky water services or water protection. So and he really made war on groups like ours. People like me were called enemies of Canada and terrorists. It was just terrible. I mean, really respectable social justice, environment, faith-based groups. They went after charitable status. They even went after a bird watching group because they were worried about this particular chemical called neonicotinoids and whether they're hurting bees. And so they cut their charitable status because, I mean, it was crazy, right? We just had a government at war with the people. So Harper was still in power when I debated Angela Merkel. So I got up and I thanked her. And I said, I thank you for meeting with us because I cannot imagine the circumstance under which my government, my prime minister would be here with me today. And then I said, you know, he calls people like me enemies of Canada. And she went like this. So I found her very human, all right? And I believe, I mean, you have to remember where she grew up. And for her, the answer is capitalism, and so she trusts those who say that this system of the free market is good. When I challenged her, I know this sounds crazy, but I wished I'd had an hour in a room alone with her, without the media and without her people, because I felt her trying to understand, because in Europe, this TTIP, this agreement between the US and Europe is really, really, really hot. I don't know if you read, but in Berlin a couple of weeks ago, there was a march. They had 250,000 people on the street because of a trade agreement with TTIP. I mean, what does that mean to anybody? Lots of people know, because it includes this investor state, ISDS, the right of corporations from North America to sue European governments, and the right of European corporations to sue European governments. And so she knows, and I could tell when we spoke about it, that it was troubling her. She said she hoped that the new proposed court system that they're looking at, they're calling for a reform of TTIP and the ISDS to set up a permanent court. So her mind was there, and she was worried about it. And when she spoke about empowerment of women, she was very, very passionate. I just feel she's like a lot of our leaders, even social democrats. They get brainwashed around these macroeconomic policies. They get believing that there's only, as one politician said to me, "Maude, the train's left the station. There's only one train and everybody has to get on it." And I said, no. Who wrote the rules that there's only one train? Where is there only one train in the world? Why, where does that come from, right? You have no alternative to market-based capitalism. So I just felt there was an opening, and I feel there's an opening in Paris around this, because we've got Obama, who's leaving soon, and he's got a legacy to care about. We've got a new prime minister who's going to come with a much better platform. China's talking seriously for the first time. I mean, it may be that this will be the breakthrough place, you know, for us. And I feel that the truth of our critique of this system is percolating everywhere. I really do. I don't mean to be naive on this, but I feel that there's a new moment here. And so that's a long answer, but I liked her. I just wished we could just sit over a cup of tea and she wouldn't have to worry about all the cameras on her and all the things that she had to say. I like the way she dressed. It was a jacket I've seen on television about 1,000 times. It was the same jacket. You know that pink jacket she has? She wore the same pink jacket. Do you know what I mean? She's just like a person. She just struck me as a down-to-earth person. And I'm not supporting her policies or my government's policies, but just as a person, I liked her. And my husband, who isn't here because he's out enjoying your city, because he doesn't want to get depressed listening to me, put on a robe, went down to the gym in our hotel we were staying at. So I took a picture of him in this bathrobe on the balcony, and he said that he was just going off to the gym with Mr. Merkel. So he sent it to everybody, and everybody believed him. He said, "Andrew, you can't say that." My husband's crazy. What can I tell you? Mr. Merkel and my husband did not go to the gym. Let me, in case you've seen this out there on the Andrew in his robe going off to the gym with Mr. Merkel, no. But yeah, it was a very interesting day, a very interesting day.
You mentioned the Swiss company which is involved. Could you say a bit more about that? How and which company it is? Nestle?
Nestle, yeah. Yeah, the two biggest water utilities are Suez and Veolia. They're from France. And they're very, very keen on these trade agreements because they get to lock in privatization. It's really important that you understand that. And this is the TISA service, the agreement on services. If it includes an investor state provision, this ISDS, it will mean that anything, anywhere that's been privatized will be almost impossible to undo, because the corporations can sue you for compensation. The company in Switzerland that we're most concerned about is Nestle. Nestle has a great deal of power here in Switzerland and around the world. And I write kind of extensively about Nestle in the book Blue Future, because I'm really concerned not only about its promotion of bottled water. There are places in the world where you cannot turn on the tap and get clean water. I understand that, but that's not true here. You can turn on the water on the tap and get beautiful water. You don't need, you know, plastic bottles of water. But my biggest concern is that Nestle promotes water privatization through Peter Brabeck, former CEO of Nestle. And Peter Brabeck is the most senior advisor to the World Bank on water policy in the Global South. It's a group called the Water Resources Group 2030. And it was set up by the World Economic Council and the World Bank. And he literally is the most powerful advisor, also advises the UN. And he advises privatization. This is a man who once said he didn't believe in the human right to water, and then he said, okay, well, I would put 1.5% of the world's water aside for the poor, and the rest goes on the market, the open market for sale. Got a big heart. And he is advising the government of Alberta in my country, which has been looking at opening up water trading, the first place in Canada to bring in water trading. So we've been very concerned with his impact, even in a so-called first world country. His impact is powerful. But what happens with the World Bank is that it comes with conditions. So they say to a poor country, if you want money for water services, for infrastructure, for water delivery, you have to bring in a private company. And then Peter Brabeck advises that on one hand as an advisor to the World Bank, and then his company, Nestle, gets to sell Pure Life to the poor who can't afford it if that water is privatized. Or if it's never privatized and just a promise, then even more people need it. So I think that I call the bottled water industry water hunters. I mean, I think, and we're working in many communities around the world where Peter Babick and the bottled water people will say, yes, but we don't use anywhere near as much as agriculture, and that's true. But they use it specifically in a particular place. So if they set up a plant on a stream or an aquifer, they mine the water till it's gone, and then they move on, and they leave the local people without water. We're working with communities around the water where not just Nestle, but other bottled water companies have mined the water there really relentlessly, and that's one of the issues in São Lourenço in Brazil. The water, you can smell it. You walk through the water park. This is this famous mineral water park, and you can smell it just smells. There's just something gone very wrong with the water. So I think that I would say that we need to challenge the power of these corporations to set policy in Switzerland. How much power does Nestle have in getting the Swiss government to promote public-private partnerships? That's a really good question that I think would need to be asked. Now, I'm at Lisa's mercy in terms of time, so you tell me how many.
Wir haben noch Zeit für eine letzte Frage.
Thanks very much for this very inspiring talk. One question related to the previous question on. There are different forms of privatization or public-private partnerships. Do you think there are forms that may be beneficial, thinking about involvement of local or national private sector?
Yeah, there are local, and often in small communities, it's a local private, not-for-profit, not a big corporation that does it, because the community isn't big enough to have a big public system. I just go to my country, in our First Nations communities, it's often a small indigenous private company that supplies water. And I have no problem with that. And in fact, in France, it was the forerunners of Suez and Veolia ran the privately ran the system for decades. And they made enough money to live, but they weren't a big corporations making huge profits for shareholders. It's when you're a big company and you have shareholders, and what happens is that you have to take the same amount of public money that the public sector would use, but you have to cut corners so you can find 15 to 20% profit for your shareholders. That's the problem. It's not that they intend to be bad, it's that you have to find, from the same amount of money that the public sector would use, you have to find ways to cut corners so that you can find the profit. And the examples around the world are over and over and over again, very clear. But yes, and I mean, in local communities, sometimes I give an example between the way we have in Canada, we have doctors who are technically private, but we have socialized insurance, so everybody pays insurance through their taxes, so the doctor will bill for each visit to the government, opposed to the United States, where they have these big HMOs, these health management organizations, which are now corporations, which now have shareholders. So if you go to the doctor has to bill you not only enough to pay him or herself for what they just did for you, but they have to make enough money for the shareholders. That's the difference to me, if that makes sense. It's when the profit motive enters in, and there's a place for the private sector in building the infrastructure and laying the pipes. I'm not against the private sector, but I think we have to ask what is the appropriate role of the private sector and the public sector. And when you're talking about the delivery of water and wastewater services as a human right, as a public service, then I don't believe the profit motive belongs there. Lay the pipes and make money, I have no problem with that. But in running a system, the money that is collected from either from taxes or from service charges should go back into keeping the watershed clean, you know, cleaning the water, ensuring that everyone has access, ensuring sustainability. And I'll tell you, very interestingly, when Paris didn't renew the last private contract with Suez and Veolia, and they brought in a public system, within 2 years they were able to lower the rate, really dramatically lower the rate of water to their customers, their citizens, and they had a big amount of money they were able to put into sustainability and to improving the infrastructure. So we have really good examples of around the world where bringing these systems back into the public service is good for the environment, and it's good for the human right to water, which in the end, these are the two issues that we have to kind of keep in front of us. And I just know we have to end, but I just want to end with the advice of a 95-year-old friend of mine, all right? She's seen everything. She's been an activist since she was like 2 years old. And she's relentless. She says, every day you have to be an activist, and every day, and don't take a day off. And I say, give me a break, you know. My husband's mad enough at me already, right? She says, fighting for justice, it's something you do every day. Like, it's like taking a bath. You do it every day, or you stink, she says. Thank you.